I will talk with you tonight about my experience, my inspiration, and a bit of the journey I undertook to create the images you see before you. I won't be talking about photography techniques or the dreaded Photoshop word. I won't be talking about equipment or anything else like that, but afterward I'm delighted to answer any questions that you might have. There are no secrets. The work you see before you are composites of my original images. Each has an historical and often a personal as well as aesthetic reason for being blended together. I also look forward to discussing a few of the images with you, but now the inspiration for the project. As a lifelong student of history, when a Dutch friend offered a road trip through Germany in 2010, I jumped at the chance. Knowing that Anne Frank had died at Bergen-Belsen, we made that our first stop. Confronted with beauty in a place that in my mind and heart told me should be an horrific place, a black and white place, a place of drizzle and smoke and barking dogs and shouting and pain-filled wailing. Instead, I saw glorious reds and golds, oranges and yellows of an autumnal forest. I was completely destabilized by this. I made photos of the forest and the various memorials, and then made my way through the museum. Inside the museum, I saw a painting by a survivor of railroad tracks and made a photograph of it because I was compelled to. Later, looking at my images, I took a moment and the inspiration came to me to overlay an image from the forest with the image of the railroad tracks in the painting. I've never shown that to anyone because it's not completely my artwork. But it was an interesting juxtaposition, this idea of memory overlaid on the present. Continuing our journey, while stopping in towns in East Germany, I discovered Stolperstein. Stolperstein translates roughly to stumbling block, and it's an art project created by a gentleman named Gunther Demnig. Begun in the mid-90s or so, he has taken brass markers, 4-inch brass markers, and embedded them in sidewalks throughout towns all over Eastern Europe to mark the place where victims were deported from their homes. Often you'll see their name, their date of birth, if it's known, the date and place of their death, if it's known, and you're just walking along the small towns and big cities, and if you're paying any attention whatsoever, you'll see this brass marker. It makes you stop and think. Seeing that project was the first thing that told me that it's possible to create a compelling, authentic, and reverent art project about a subject as important and difficult as the Holocaust. Traveling further east in the Czech Republic, I visited Prague, the legendary city of music and literature, art and philosophy, a city renowned for its culture long before and despite its years behind the Iron Curtain. Walking through the Jewish cemetery, I was again destabilized by this visual jumble of thousands of markers spanning 7 centuries. And then the 80,000 names inscribed on the wall in the memorial of the Pinka Synagogue. The last blow to my psyche was seeing the original artwork of the children who passed through Theresienstadt, now Terezin. I decided then to make my way there. I made images, but none that could communicate what I was feeling. I used different lenses, I used different techniques, camera motion, anything that I could to figure out how to speak photographically and to try to communicate what I was feeling. None of them were successful. Making my way out to Terezin, I had to confront a town that is a living, breathing community. I thought, how can this be? I was in such disbelief that I had arrived at the right place that I left and drove a half mile out to the small fortress. And I thought, okay, this feels a little bit more like it should. The town was just too surreal, too bizarre. I talked with an historian in the small fortress and had an informative and sobering tour, made some images, but then learned that the town was in fact the ghetto from the time of the war. People were living in the very houses, apartments, and buildings where countless people fell victim to typhus, starvation, and any other number of maladies, an indescribable horror, in a town built and inhabited by, at the most, 6,000 people, at its height during the war, held over 80,000 people. The living conditions were horrific. I left there knowing that I had not created a single image that had anything original or compelling to say. This is in 2010. Over the next year, I read and read and watched video after video, countless movies and documentaries. As I said, I've always been a student of history, so I'm familiar with the dates and numbers, the perpetrators and their motivations and machinations. But it wasn't until I read Hannibal Brenner's book, The Girls of Room 28, that I felt that I could tell my own story of what I saw and how I felt. Their story of hope and joy and friendship, alongside the sorrow, loss, and tragedy, spoke to me about the importance of the creative act. They spoke about drawing and singing, creating poems, attending concerts and recitals, acting in plays, and the sustaining memories that they created along with their friends, and the joy and the hope that it gave them during their time there. They meet together now once a year, the survivors that are left, there are still 7 of them, and they still laugh and sing their songs and tell the stories of their other friends. Alice Hurst Sumner, the noted pianist who died just recently at 110 years old, said that it would not be too strong to say that the music fed them. Their example showed me that I could, as an artist, create my own solace and create and depict the beauty that I saw in this land of infinite sorrow. I returned to Tennessee in November of 2011, determined to create an authentic, original project.